Good. So I officially welcome all of you to our Seleucid lecture series. And this time, well, unfortunately, my co-host, Rabbi Ben Skolnick, is not with us because he's traveling in Israel. But he sends you, Kathy, and all the other participants his cordial greetings. So our speaker today is Dr. Ekaterina Bertson from Moscow. She gained her Master of History at the University of St. Petersburg in 2016. And from there, she moved to Russia, to Moscow, to the Russian state, to the Moscow State University. And while she was doing her PhD, I had the pleasure to meet her for the first time when she was co-hosting me in Moscow in 2017, I think it was. She then joined the Seleucid study group for the first time at Sopot near Gdansk in 2019, where she presented from her PhD studies. It was an argument on I think it was on Demetrius the first or the second, and it was from the Babylonian Astronomical Diaries, which is, I think, the main source of her investigations. And we from the Seleucid study groups are particularly grateful that ever more young colleagues are studying Akkadian inscriptions to enrich our discussion so that we are no longer only depending on Greek and Latin sources. So her PhD was finished and defended in 2021. And from that stage, she moved on to the Institute of Oriental Studies at the Russian Academy of Sciences, also in Moscow. And there she is, working on a second thesis, which is comparable to the habilitation thesis, which prepares her for a professorship. I've already counted 6 article publications of hers, 4 in Russian and 2 in English. So the Russian publication includes one in Vestnik Drevni Istori, so the flagship journal in Russia. And there is another publication in Ricerche Ellenistiche, which is on Archaios the Elder. So all these article publications hover around the Babylonian Astronomical Diaries, early and mid Seleucid history of events, but also history of institutions. I move on to introducing our expert who is going to give feedback after the presentation. I'm very pleased that Dr. Marijn Fischer is joining us from Bergen in Norway today. There she is holding an associate professorship since last year, and she was prepared for that through her PhD, which she gained in Durham University in 2017. And this was then published, I think, with Cambridge University Press, under the title Beyond Alexandria, Literature and Empire in the Seleucid World. And I think her career started at Leiden University. I had the pleasure to meet Marijn for the first time in Brussels for Seleucid Study Day 5, where she contributed, already a probe of her knowledge in Seleucid literature, the court literature around Antiochus III, which then also formed an important chapter in the proceedings published in 2019. So I'm very grateful that you are here for us to give expert feedback. But now all the floor goes to Kathy, and the title of her presentation is The Deer Son of a Bull, Some Remarks on the Interpretation of the So-Called Phaenis Oracle, Pausanias 10:15-3.
Can I share my screen?
Yes, please.
Mm-hmm. Dear colleagues, I'm very glad to be here and present my little research at these lectures. Today, I want to tell you about one plot which may be related to the history of the first lipids. The text that will be discussed is a little unusual. It's prophecy. Working with such a type of sources is not easy task, and other conclusions, of course, cannot be absolute. But since our text has references to some historical events, let's try to understand the mysterious words of that Apollo spoke through his prophetess and read them in the historical context of the early Hellenistic period. Most of the Hellenistic oracles and prophecies known to us belong to the period of early Hellenism, a time of great changes in the destiny of the Eastern Mediterranean. However, many of these prophecies are more political than religious or eschatological in nature and refer to very specific events or historical features. In the context of the selected history, we can recall the oracles and omens associated with Seleucus Nicator, the founder of the Seleucid dynasty. They entered the canon of so-called Romance of Seleucus and are usually regarded as a part of the literary tradition reflecting the official point of view of the Seleucid court. They substantiate the choiceness of Seleucus, his greatness, future domination over Asia, etc. I will mention the most famous of them. Of course, most of them are associated with the oracles of Apollo. The first one from Diodorus, when Seleucus I consulted the god in Bralhide, he addressed him as King Seleucus, Seleucon Basileia. Another prophecy was given by oracle of Apollo at Didyma, who forbade Seleucus to return to Europe, Mesperda Europa de Asiata Apollon Amenon. We also know about an advice to avoid Argos and the oracle which inspired Seleucus to take care of Syria and especially Daphne and promised him a good fortune. This canon takes shape after the death of Seleucus, but it may begin to form during the lifetime of the king. The legends and omens that shrouded the personalities of Alexander and the Diodorus meet a very specific request: the legitimization of the first generation of the Hellenistic kings through the demonstration of their exclusivity and closeness to the gods. Another numerous group of oracles is associated with the Galatian invasion of the Balkans and Asia Minor in the early 217 BC, and thus falls mainly on the time of Epigones. The main studies on this topic are given on this slide. Here I have collected the main works on my topic. The so-called Oracle of Phanes, cited by Pausanias in his description of Greece, the main object of my study, belongs to the category of Galatian prophecies, but in my opinion, it can also be included in the group of Seleucid oracles. Let's consider it in more detail. Then, wearily, having crossed the narrow strait of the Hellespont, the devastating host of the Galatians shall pipe, and lawlessly they shall ravage Asia. And much worse shall God do to those who dwell by the shores of the sea for a short while. For right soon the son of Cronus shall raise them a helper, the dear son of a bull reared by Zeus, who on all the Galatians shall bring a day of destruction. By the son of a bull, she, Phaenis, meant Attalus, king of Pergamon, who was also styled bullhorned by an oracle. As we can see, the prophecy predicts the arrival of the Galatians in Asia and the disasters that it will bring to those who dwell by the shores of the sea. This part of the oracle obviously refers to a real historical event, the Galatian invasion of Asia that took place in the winter of 277 BC. This is clearly indicated by the reference to the crossing of the Hellespont, Amaipsamenos steinon poron Hellespontu. Those who dwell by the shores of the sea, we now seen par Ionesi Thalasses, are apparently the coastal Greek polis, who seems to have been the target audience of the oracle. Prophecy predicts some period of suffering for them. However, soon the son of Cronus shall raise them a helper, the dear son of a bull, reared by Zeus, who on all the Galatians shall bring day of destruction. Since the prophecy refers to well-known historical events, it seems to be important to ask, who is the historical prototype of mysterious dear son of a bull, Taurio Philon Ion? Anticipating this, Pausanias gives his own explanation for these words. By the son of a bull, she, Phaenis, meant Attalus, king of Pergamon, who was also styled bull-horned, Taurokeron, by another oracle. However, this interpretation has a number of logical inconsistencies. The first one is chronological. The Galatians crossed over to Asia in the winter of 278 BC, but Attalus I defeated them only after his coming to power in Pergamon circa 241 or even later. A gap of almost 40 years is hardly compatible with the indication sum, taha. Moreover, Pergamon inscriptions, August 269 and 276, specify that Attalus defeated only the Tolistoagioi, why Phaenis speaks of the victory over all the Galatians, passing Galatesin, Lethrion, Emar, Ephesi. This detail will not be so important in itself, but in the general context, it should not be neglected. One more embarrassing detail in the interpretation of Pausanias concerns with the epithet of Attalus, Taurokeron, bull-horned, which is known to our author from another oracle, Presterion. This oracle could be the Pythia of Delphi, who allegedly gave a prophecy to Attalus and called him Taurokeron. Courage, O bull-horned one, Taurokeros. You will have regal honors, and the sons of your son will have them too, but your great grandsons will not. However, there is no hint of the Galatians in Diodorus. The oracle refers only to the accession of Attalus and the duration of his dynasty's reign, two generations after him. This means that it was created after the death of Attalus III in 133 BC. And we have no reason to connect the Galatian oracle of Phaenis with the prophecy of the Pythia. And the son of a bull is not the same as bull-horned. All this suggests that the oracle in Pausanias may be related also to the early stage of the struggle with the Galatians and has nothing to do with Attalus. A second point is that another prophecy attributed to Phaenis also refers to the early period of the Galatian invasion and their raids in Anatolia. The addressee of this letter is the king of Thracians, Basileo Trekpon, who apparently was the Bithynian king Nicomedes I. The lion and wolf mentioned definitely suggest allusions to the Galatian chiefs Leonorius and Lotarius. The general tone of this oracle is rather gloomy. According to Protus, then the Wolves will settle the Bithynian land, there is no question of any victory. This means that the oracle of Philinus has given to the king of Thracians clearly refers to the events of the first half of the 270s. This is another argument in favor of the early dating of the oracle in Pausanias, in my opinion. Now, let's move on to another interesting clue from Pausanias. In another episode, he reports that Phaenis, daughter of king of the Conians, was born when Antiochus was establishing his kingship immediately after the capture of Demetrius. I believe that this is a reference to the events of the 280s and to Antiochus I and Demetrius Poliorcetes, who was captured relatively shortly before accession of Antiochus. Here I should add that in the 10th book of his description of Greece, Pausanias tells about the invasion of the Galatians into Greece, and Antiochus I is mentioned here there again. So there is no logical contradiction in this narrative. As for the gap between the capture of Demetrius Poliorcetes and the accession to the throne of Antiochus I, it can be explained by the fact that for Pausanias, these events are only general reference points for the chronology of 280s BC. This reference to the reign of Antiochus I seems at first sight taken out of context, but it's actually pointing to a solution for our problem with the prophecy. Since Oracle of Phaenis refers to the early stage of the struggle against the Galatians, to the events of 270s-60s BC, we have reason to see this lurking trace here. And Antiochus I seems to be the most suitable diason of a bull, given the important victory over the Galatians attributed to this king. We know little about the details of these campaigns, but it's certain that the Galatian factor played an important role in the ideology of the early Seleucids, so that a Seleucid context is obvious choice for Phaenis oracle. Now, let's try to analyze this text on the Seleucid vein. As we can see, the language of the prophecy is artificially archaic and stylized as the language of Homer's poems. This is not surprising given the nature of this genre. More interesting are the images used by the prophetess. Some of them seem to contain direct references to Homer. The phrase «Tahe garsvin aosatero kranion hormesi» seems to be a paraphrase of a passage from the Iliad, «Carsinium, rion to aosatero kranion ex ides proeoke restamene kai amune». Take courage now, such a helper has the son of Cronus sent down from Ida to stand by your side and defend you. The Iliad refers to Apollo, while the oracle means a certain person who will become a helper to the Hellenes, who dwell by the shores of the sea and were suffering at the hands of the Galatians, just as Apollo came to the aid of the wounded Hector. The word aosater, helper, is synonymous with soter, savior, and may allude to the epithet of Antiochus I, who is usually associated precisely with the Galatian victory of this king. The diason is also styled in the language of Homer, for example, as Apollona, hymn to Apollo. But what role does the bull Taurus play? Perhaps there can also be a logical continuation of the above quoted from the Iliad. Then Zeus sends Apollo from Mount Ida, ex Ides. Now the son of a bull, reared by him, Taurio Diotrephaeus Philion Gion, comes from behind the Taurus mountains. The same idea can be traced in the Ilion decree in honor of King Antiochus, August 219, certainly Antiochus the first, not the third, I think. And now King Antiochus, having arrived in the region on the side of the Taurus, with all energy and love of glory, he has simultaneously achieved peace for the cities. Also, there are no references to the Galatian war in the decree of Ilion. It has a great value for us as one of the rare contemporary sources. Then arrival of the king in the area west of Taurus meant the establishment of peace and order in this region. Unfortunately, we do not know exact date of this decree. However, according to the context, it's usually attributed to the first part of the reign of Antiochus I. In this sense, the first arrival of Antiochus from beyond Taurus, from the upper satrapies, where he had already been king for a long time, was of particular importance, since it means his actual entry into possession of his Anatolian domain inherited from his father. Another idea expressed in the Ilion decree resonates with the ideological message of our oracle. The king has not only his friends and armed forces as loyal supporters, quite traditional formula, but also the well-disposed deity, his divine helper. It's not enough to be king by right of sphere or even inheritance. A legitimate king rules with the support of a god. The same message is present in the famous oracle. Zeus has sent the dear son of a bull to help the Hellenists suffering from the Galatian rites, Taha Gar, Svin Ausater, Kranion, Hormesi, Taurio Diotrophaeus, Philon Hion. The actions of the Galatians are unlawful. Athemistos. Why Antiochus established justice and punished those who had attacked his kingdom? Sought by punishing as well right to those who attack the state. Again, quote from the Ilion decree. Some associations of Seleucus I with a bull would also be reflected in the image of Taurus. Parallels to this can be found in the so-called romance of Seleucus. For example, in Appian, Syriake, he, Seleucus, was big and strong in body. Once when Alexander was sacrificing a wild bull, the creature broke out of its bonds, but Seleucus held it fast alone and with only his bare hands. This is why they add horns to his teachers. And a small detail from Suda. They say that when Seleucus was with Alexander of Macedon and Alexander was sacrificing a bull, it ran away. Seleucus single-handedly overrode the bull by grappling its horns. This is why they decorate his statues with the horns of the head. But there are later examples, we hear more earlier ones. Some issues of Seleucus himself, for example, coins from the Drachm of Seleucus minted in Susa, Drachm from Ecbatana, coins of his son Antiochus I, tetradrachm minted in Sardis with diademed and bullhorned head of Seleucus I, and drachm of Antiochus with diademed and bullhorned head of Seleucus from mint in Bactria. All of this are good examples for this bull image of the Seleucus, as well as early Hellenistic seal impressions from Seleucia on the Tigris and Uruk from Hellenistic Babylonia, with the bull horned portrait of Seleucus I also suggest the early development of such an image. This iconographic tradition proved to be stable. On the famous mosaics from Apamea, depicting the scenes of the founding of Syrian cities of Antioch and Apamea, the head of Seleucus is also styled with bull horns. The divine connotations of bull horns in the ancient Middle Eastern tradition are well known, as well as the popularity of this element on early Seleucid coins. I mean bull horn stallions, elephants, helmets. So I won't comment on that in detail. In any case, we have a sufficient number of examples showing the popularity of this image in the early Seleucid ideology. Therefore, the interpretation of the phrase son of the bull, in the sense the son of Seleucus Nicator, can also take place. Maybe there was a play on words in the prophecy. If this is correct, then the topic of recovering of the ancestral rule comes up again, just as in Iron decree to recover his ancestral rule. So the ideological message of the oracle seems quite transparent, and the well-known semantic series, Antiochus, Apollo, Soter, already seem quite clear. The king, acting on the will of the god, performs the functions of the same deity. And if in Greece Apollo himself stood up to protect his sanctuary in Delphi, in Asia he delegated these functions to Antiochus, who was claimed to be his descendant. Initially, the helper of the Hellenists later becomes the savior that suggests more intense divine connotations. If this logic is correct, the oracle may demonstrate one of the early stages of the formation of a royal cult in the Seleucid kingdom. This slide contains the most famous examples demonstrating the use of the cult Epiclesia Soter in relation to Antiochus I in the Seleucid inscription and even on coins, I mean so-called Soter coinage. And one last thing I want to talk about, when could this oracle have been composed? It's difficult to give a reasonable answer to this question. Pausanias places the birth of Aenys in the second half of 218th, and it's the period when a king of Caunus, her father, could be a real person. But I'm not sure how reliable this information can be. For this reason, I prefer to focus more on the general context of the prophecy and relevance of this topic for the Seleucid royal ideology. It seems more likely that the prophecy was created in the second part in the reign of Antiochus I, when some successes in the fight against the Galatians had already been achieved. Pisin, Galatesin, Alethrion, Emar, Ephesin. And it became possible to fit them into the royal ideology, completing the formation of the image of the Savior King in the eyes of the Greek polis. We can recall the decree of the Ionian League, which dates from the second half of 260 BC. It cannot also be excluded the beginning of the reign of Antiochus II, because his ideology contains many references to Antiochus I, which is quite understandable. Such a chronology does not contradict the supposed age of Aenys. She was about 30 years old, so I will get attached to that detail. I even admit that this prophecy could have been compiled by the poets of the Seleucid court. This can be indirectly indicated by such an obvious parallelism to Homer, and passed off as an oracle of the real Aeneas at a later stage. The educated Greek audience know the Iliad very well and could easily read the images encoded in the prophecy. In that case, The upper chronological boundary of the oracle can be drawn to the mid of 270, about 275, I think. Then it correlates well with another pious oracle given to the king of Thracians. As for the lower bound, it seems unlikely to me that the prophecy could have been created after 250 BC, since by the time the concept of soteria of Antiochus I had already been formed, and the theme with bullhorns is also gradually falling out of fashion. Besides, the geography of both Phoenician oracles is quite closely connected with the region of the Straits. This also serves as indirect reference to events no later than the middle of the 3rd century BC, the time of Seleucid activity in this region. Summarizing, I tend to determine the time of the creation of the oracle between the middle of 270th and 250th. Also, I should admit that such chronology cannot be considered absolute. The appearance of Attalus in our text can also be explained. We know about some collections of prophecies. Perhaps Pausanias took our oracle from such a collection. He may correlate the oracle of Phoenix with the prophecy by the Pythia of Delphi referring to Attalus, where he is called Taurocron. It's difficult to say whether there is an interpretation of Pausanias himself or an adaptation of a Seleucid ideological pattern in the case of the Attalists. This question requires separate consideration, but for now I still tend to the first point of view because we do not have direct indications of this in the sources. At the same time, it's hard to deny that Attalus I to some extent followed the Seleucid model invented by Antiochus I. This is evidenced by the active use of the Galatian theme in the Pergamon ideology. The theme can be said about the royal epithet of Attalus, Soter, the theme and that of Antiochus. Such a similarity could also play in favor of the late attribution of the oracle to Attalus I. In conclusion, I would like to say that if our interpretation of Phoenix's oracle is correct, her prophecy can be considered one of the earliest examples of the inclusion of the Galatian theme in the history of Seleucid ideology. The analogy between Apollo and the Severe King apparently draws on the early royal cult. Finally, the prophecy can also demonstrate the intention of the early Seleucids to strengthen their assertion among Greek polis through the use of the will of the god as an instrument of legitimation. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, dear Kathy, for this very clear and convincing presentation. I'm not saying anything more, but immediately pass on the word to Marijn for her feedback.
Yes, thank you. That was great. I had the pleasure of reading your paper beforehand as well, and I really enjoyed it. But it was great to hear you tell it to us as well and see some of the coins. And we were very lucky, the people who were early, because we got to see the real a physical example of the coin as well, one of the coins, so that was really nice. Yes, I really enjoyed how you put this text into the Seleucid context, and I'm looking forward to discussing some of the issues with you. I phrased my response partly around questions, but I will kind of go through it, and then you can come back with some of the points you want to answer, if that's okay, Altai. Yes, can you hear me?
I can. Yeah. I was nodding, but I was on mute.
Okay, no, that's fine.
But all good.
Yes.
But I have problems with that's okay.
Is it okay? Okay, perfect. So
One second. Sometimes there are some technical problems. Kathy, if you experience technical problem,
I hear you, but it's very slow.
Yeah, I recommend that you close your camera so that you have potentially a better audio connection and so that you can fully understand Marijn's comment. I hope that this improves the situation a little bit.
Better. Mm-hmm. Okay.
I will also do this to kind of open up all the bandwidth available and see if that helps. So I wanted to start basically addressing your final point about how you place the original oracle and the literary prophecy kind of in this historical context. So you mentioned the creation at the Seleucid court as a potential place of the creation of this oracle. I was wondering if you were could in kind of think about specific authors. And I was thinking here about, for example, the poet Aratus, who, according to some sources, was there at the court of Antiochus I, and of course wrote also, we know, poems commissioned to royal patrons for Antigonos. So this was just a little kind of thinking exercise. We probably will never be able to say anything about this for certain, but I was wondering if you had thought about this at all. And then the other thing I was wondering about when I was thinking about this prophecy, and especially, I really enjoy how you kind of critique the Pausanian attribution of this prophecy and go through it and show us kind of the historical context of these problems. But how would you imagine if it started out as a kind of Seleucid court literature, could we even say royal propaganda? So you use the word royal ideology, but how did it end up being attributed to this apparate princess, Phaianis? Was she an oracle that then had oracle collections about the Galatians and this kind of ended up in one of these books? Or have you thought, did you think about kind of the process, how this text ended up attached to her name, not only to Attalus's name, but specifically to her? And I do think it's interesting that you raised the question if the Attalid court might have kind of appropriated some of these imagery and messages, but that again is yet another question, of course. So I was specifically interested in how this prophecy kind of was put into her mouth, to Phaianis's mouth. And one of the other themes I wanted to address was the attribution of kind of the son of the bull, right? Seleucus the First as this bull. And I thought that was a really nice reading, and I'm really quite convinced by it. And as you say, kind of bullhorned is not the same as being a bull, and it's quite a strong statement in a way. And I'm not sure we have that many other examples in the Greek literature where kind of we have this Seleucus is a bull, because even in the coins, as you showed us, he also is bullhorned. And there I was thinking, did you look at the near, you mentioned the Near Eastern bullhorned diadems and crowns, but I was reading a book by Eva Anagnostou Laotides. I'm not sure if you have seen it too. It was called In the Garden of the Gods, Models of Kingship from the Sumerians to the Seleucids. It was really interesting. And I think you would find it also really interesting too, because it was really about this ancient Near Eastern concept of the king as the ball, where they really are equated together. And I think we could think about this kind of in that very strong Near Eastern context where the king is the bull. And then we have one Homeric reference where Agamemnon is compared to a bull in a Homeric simile in the Iliad, the second book of the Iliad, 480. I'm not sure if you have taken that reference, if you have looked at that reference, but there the Agamemnon is, as the king of all the Greeks, is compared to the most chiefest overall, a bull standing out amongst the herd. And that I was thinking connects really well with the adjective here, the nourished by Zeus, or the kind of, the diotrephios, where I think in Homer that adjective really is used for kings. It is a specific royal adjective. But I haven't really kind of looked all the way into that, but it would be interesting to see if that point stands, because then you kind of strengthen your point, I think. But of course, the bull of heaven, the Near Eastern bull of heaven here, really also sprang into my mind. So I was really interested to hear if you thought that this could be an example of kind of quite a strong Near Eastern royal ideology coming into the Seleucid royal ideology. But all of these comments and questions, they are also kind of thought experiments and questions out of interest for you. So I really thought your argument was very convincing. And if I can have, oh yeah, and then one other thing I wanted to, was thinking about the bull, because you have Seleucus as the bull, but then you also have this other image of the Tauros, right? As you say, the Tauros mountains, and in my mind, the story of Seleucus grappling with the bull and kind of showing his strength and subduing the bull, I always read this as him subduing the mountain range, basically. First and foremost. And I was wondering, do we see the double reading here, as you say, coming from the Taurus mountains, and kind of the bull is connected to this as a kind of double layered meaning, or are they slightly at odds with each other, and should we then choose between one reading or the other, or would you say they work actually nicely if you stack them on top of each other? I was wondering if they are pulling slightly in two different directions, or if you think they actually reinforce each other, because that I think would be interesting to tease out. I mean, if the bull is referring to the Taurus mountains, how does that then kind of connect with if it is referring to the king? But that would be interesting to hear your thoughts on that. And the kind of final thing I was thinking about, and I thought it was really interesting because I am currently working on the Sibylline Oracle book 3, which is a text that is a bit later, but it's also these literary oracles about kings, and which puts kind of this Phaianis oracle almost, instead of putting it in all these really kind of quite brief political early Hellenistic oracles, you could also read them in the tradition of these later longer hexameter oracle poems. And there, what I thought, what is of course, and you point out, is still really important, the Hellespont and the kind of Europe-Asia kind of juxtaposition, as you say in your paper, right? This is what it kind of is all about. Don't go to Europe, Asia is better for you, and kind of this narrative. But both in the Sibylline oracles and in this oracle, what I thought was interesting was kind of the threat comes from Europe, And Asia is the one who's under attack here. And the other thing we see in the Sibylline oracles is also that God, and in this case it's the Jewish God, but I think there are other Near Eastern examples. For example, with Cyrus, King Cyrus, where it's both Marduk and the Jewish God that have this story attached to them, that the God takes a king to save the people, right? And this idea that the God chooses a king as his chosen king to go and save the people. And that might be another kind of background or ideological context to read it in. So not just Zeus sending out Apollo to help the Greeks, but this, as you say, this idea that that God legitimizes the king, and that this is legitimate kingship. But there, I think you have some other nice oracular examples that come to make similar points. Okay, so I'll stop there and I'll put on my video again. I hope you could follow my points, and I'm really looking forward to discussing these things further with you.
Yes, thank you very much for your feedback and support of my ideas. Too many questions. I'll try to answer to it. About the context of Oracle and by whom he was composed, if we consider the idea of that it was composed in the Seleucid court about Eratus. I was thinking about it, and it's very I think that Eratus, who worked in the library in NTU under the editing of Iliad, is a most suitable person for the compose as a to be considered as a author of this oracle. But I don't know how we can prove it. It's a hard work. Why Phaenis? I also was thinking about it. I don't know, actually, but maybe because she was a famous prophetess of its time, and maybe, actually, I don't know. I want to think about it.
Yes, especially if you think about, there are also some a symbol mm-hmm. kind of prophet. Isn't one of them? One of the famous one lives in Asia Minor, so that would be such a logical prophetess mm-hmm. to connect it to, I would think. So I was, yeah, seems to me a slightly odd choice, but it's hard to come to an answer, right? That is, yeah.
Yes, and about any ancient Near Eastern connections with the bull as a symbol, bull horns as a symbol of guards, of royal power. Yes, I know the book of Anagnosta Leotidas about Babylonian kingship in the Hellenistic time. And of course, I think there can be a Near Eastern connection of this image initially, because the Babylon was the center of this the very first Seleucid satrapy, the heart of his future kingdom. But later, I don't know how it was appropriate for the his Greek audience from Asia Minor. I don't know, but maybe it's very, very interesting thing because the decree of Ilion, to which I refer in my paper. As I remember, Paul Cosmin wrote that there are any similarities between language and ideas of this decree with the Behistun inscription of Darius. For example, the idea of the god who is helper of the king is not usual for Hellenistic royal decrees. Who is this god, the good daimonion, if I remember correctly? It's very similar to Vaishnava Mazdaha from the Histon inscription, as well as idea of justice. It's not very common in Hellenistic texts because usually king is Euergetes, Soter, but Dikaios, it's only in Greek Obactria as epithet, yes, if I remember correctly. So this concept of early Seleucid ideology are very interesting, and I think I would like to write about it separately. About Agamemnon compares with Bull in the Iliad, it's very interesting and comparison. Thank you very much. Agamemnon's great king and Seleucus, the founder of the dynasty, is a great king. Yes, it's a great parallel for Seleucus as a bull. What about the meaning of Taurus mundane, double reading of the bull? I think it can took place in the arrow prophecy, but the son of a bull in the meaning of Taurus mountains, maybe that means that Antiochus came from the east. He crossed the Taurus mountains, the highest mountains in the border between Asia Minor and Great Asia, and he was like a son of these mountains. I don't know why at all, but it's very interesting idea. I understand that I have a little agreements to explain it, but I try to consider and such variant. Thank you again for your ideas, for your support of my hypothesis. I would like to read your book about oracles in future. Thank you. When last summer I read your book about Seleucid literature and had a great pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you. That's very kind.
Thank you, Marijn, for your very thoughtful comments, and Ekaterina for your responses. I assume that many of us have many questions or ideas. So I would like to open the floor. I have a few one, and if I do not see a hand up in 3 seconds, I will go first, but it's your chance. So please come forward with your questions, with your ideas. I think such a text is really inviting that we flip-flop our ideas and develop our arguments together. So Giovanna, please.
Hello, thank you so much, Ekaterina. I found it very fascinating. So following up on questions around this fineness and whether actually, assuming that she was the real prophetess who produced this prophecy for one of the kings, do we have any evidence of any links or between Seleucid kings and Dodona in Epirus? I mean, might there be any cultural policy there? I open this question to all the other members of this call too, if they have any ideas. I was just thinking about this.
Yeah, thank you for your question. If I remember, in the late times, in the time of Antiochus II, during his campaign in Greece, he visited this place and made sacrifice in it. But if I remember correctly, another evidence is absent, but maybe I should see the sources more. Thank you.
No, thank you. I mean, I'm noting this because I have a chapter in my PhD thesis where I discuss the Fenice Oracle. So I will certainly mention this talk, and I will possibly follow you on academia and see, you know, keep in touch. I would like to discuss this further.
Thank you.
Perhaps I can join in here and connect some threads, well, the one started by Giovanna, but also in the previous discussion. I was wondering when you and Marijn agreed that there is an Asian Sibyl and she may be behind it on the one hand. On the other hand, Faenis from Kaonia in Epirus, I'm not absolutely sure if Dodona is in Kaonia or not. I'm actually not so good with ancient Greek topography or geography, but it's so it seems to be converging on the one hand around this oracular tradition of Dodona, but then there is this particular Asia Minor flavor of the description also, as you teased it out, Ekaterina, so it's about the Epeiros of the Asia Minor coast. So really a perspective that is localized, perhaps even around Ilion, and then we have the Ilion the Ilion inscription. It's I'm trying to put the pieces together, I'm still juggling with them. They are up in the air. What to make out of the role of Faenis Kaonian descent on the one hand, but a Sibyl-like figure, Asia Minor connection. I'm still looking for the ideal description of this author, whether she is a real historical figure or whether she is more a construction and a fabricated personage. So I wonder whether we can dig out more or whether you, Marijn, or anyone else in the audience can help us put these pieces together as somewhat more concretely. And perhaps one question related to this, you gave I think it was a quotation from Pausanias, which you had on the slide with the map, where you referenced the origin. It is from Pausanias on 10, 12, 10. So what does he know about Faenis? Where does his knowledge come from? So she has a father who is king in Kaonia, but he's not named. That's very, very suspicious, I find. Do we have more specific evidence for her? Perhaps is there an alternative source that names her father?
Yes, thank you. I also think about it. Maybe I stop sharing of screen. Actually, very little information about Faenis and her father, and it came to my mind example with another Sibylla of Chaldean Sibylla or Persian, in another Persian, who considered to be a daughter of Berossus. Berossus is a historical person, well-known Babylonian historian, but what we know about him, about his Babylonian sources, we don't know. We know that he exactly lived in the time of early Hellenism, but we do not know to whom of the men mentioned in Babylonian text we can connect him with. and about his daughter, who is also a prophetess, maybe the king of Chaonians is such example, because mm-hmm. we have no another evidence on it, on this question. And about the connection between Epirus, Dodona, and the Ilion, oh, it's very interesting because I think if the Ilion decree and the references to Homer are connected, is it a coincidence or not? Because the well-known Ilion decree, it's known for us because of a big size of excavations that took place in Ilion, and it can be a coincidence because we have we have many materials from Ilion, but it may be the geological reference to Ilion was not in the first time attributed to the Greeks Ernest Politis from Ilion. I don't know exactly. We have a very little evidence for it, apparently.
Thank you. Are there other thoughts, other questions? Kishen.
Okay, so let me. Okay. Can everybody hear me all right? Does my audio work this time? Okay. Mm-hmm. Oh, awesome. Yep. First, again, thank you for the presentation. I really enjoyed it. That was really nice. So from my impression, the use of the horn image on coinage also has a longer history in Macedonian coinage. So if you look at the coins of Alexander Great and Lysimachus, you can also see the horn image on their coins. Although I think from the ways how the horns curve on those images, those appear to be ram horns. So not the bull horns, which it's interesting, I feel. So is there some observation or remark can be made there to say that there is a shift from old Macedonian way of representing royal power through coinage by using ram horns to the bull horn, which might or might not symbolize the starting of a new wave of representation or ideology in the Seleucid world, right? Stemming from that, do you also think that that if it's intentional for the oracles to specifically pick the bull horn instead of ram horns to signify that this is something that's more distinctively Seleucid rather than Macedonian?
Yeah, thank you. thank you for good examples with the horns, ram horns of Alexander. But in Macedonian connection, I remember as well the bull horns in the coinage of Demetrius Poliorcetes. It's as well as the Seleucus period of Diadochi. Maybe for Greek and Macedonian audience, it also was known and has an important significance, not only for the Babylonians or Iranians, Iranian subjects of eastern part of the Seleucids. If the image of bullhorned king was not only Eastern, but not only Oriental, but even more cosmopolitan image in the ideology of the early Hellenistic kings. So it makes interpretation of our oracle maybe even easier, if I understand you correctly. Thank you.
Thank you.
Marijn?
Yes, I was thinking a little bit more about what you were saying, Altai, and kind of maybe more brainstorming than answering any questions about Phaianis and how she might have to ended up in this kind of Hellenistic royal ideology. Because I think the time she was supposed to be alive, if we follow Pausanias's reference in Book 10, is exactly the time when Pyrrhus takes over this kingdom, or has maybe annexed Pyrrhus of Epirus. And he has Galatian mercenaries. And he, of course, is part of this Hellenistic world of kings. And so there might be, I'm not sure if I fought many battles against the Galatians. I should check up on that. But I think he had Galatian mercenaries. So there might be, that might be a ground or a point to anchor her, if we want to make her a real person with a real history rather than a literary figure. But still, she had to come from somewhere, right? Even if she's if you want to attribute oracles to her to give it weight, even as an imaginary figure, she needs to have some tradition behind her, I would say. So that could be interesting to think about. And the other thing I was thinking about, what you mentioned, Kathy, about the daughter of Berossus, the Sibyl, the Chaldonian, Chaldean Sibyl. Because I would almost think that tradition is a little bit later, when kind of these, we have suddenly these 10 different Sibyls from different cultures in the Mediterranean world, that she was attached to him, to Berossus, to kind of anchor her, rather than that she was such a big figure in the early Seleucid period, because I think all the references to her are quite late, but it would be interesting to think about further. But yes, thank you.
Yeah, thank you. If we can date Phaianis' connection with of the oracle with Phaianis' more late period, maybe it can be the first century, about a century BC or AD, a time when part of the romance of Seleucus that survived for us can be attributed. No, for example, the stories about Seleucus, Stratonis, and Antiochus. The first example is Valerius Maximus, the first century, and maybe the collection of these stories about early Hellenistic period. The most part of it, as we know, does not survive to our time, unfortunately. And maybe in this time it was reattributed to Phaianis herself or to Attalus, because of the strong connection of Attalus with Taurocheros. So it was a mix of oracles, prophecies, collections. And so we have what we have. Thank you.
Susan, please.
Yeah, the wonderful paper. It sort of boggled my mind, actually, because it causes me great consternation when I think of the use of the bull, or the son of the bull. There were no Seleucid coins that gave the image of the bull until Seleucus II. And it's interesting that they would refer to him, to Antiochus I, as the son of the bull, even though that imagery was not used until Seleucus II. And then my other thought is, Antiochus fits because Antiochus the first fits because he obviously battled the Galatians and defeated them with the use of elephants, as I recall. And so why would they not? Of course, I guess who would want to be called the son of an elephant? It's a very interesting topic, and I truly appreciate this because it causes me to really, really think about all of the imagery and the use of the oracles and who may or may not be real. Very fascinating. And I thank you so much.
Thank you. In the coinage of Antiochus I, we have no examples with the image of a living king, Antiochus with a bull horns, maybe because it has a very strong divine connotation of deified king. And there is an example at the time of Seleucus II, if I remember, the mint of Haran, yes, with the image or the head of a king, probably Seleucus I, with a bull horn. But it's only one example of this time, the middle of the third century, and the mint of Haran Kari was not very big. It's the mints of Upper Mesopotamia became active during this time. Maybe it was any local connection with the Haran Kari Upper Mesopotamian. It's very interesting that in the coinage of Antiochus I himself, we cannot see any references to elephant victory in Asia Minor. Only small issues are in Smyrna with elephant head, but in the royal coinage in the capital of Asia Minor, in Sardis, only Apollo, and I don't know why that. Thank you, Keen.
So, if there is, Gaius has a question. Yes, Gaius, please.
I'm thinking about reinterpreting the prophecy totally as if I were a Greek in 275 BC or earlier. And I realized that, you know, for modern people sometimes don't pay attention to a few of the details that are obvious to people in the ancient world, that a bull is the most powerful land animal. So for the ancient Greeks, the bull is what the lion is in medieval heraldry. And that Zeus as a bull steals Europa from Asia and takes her to Europe. And Zeus is the bull and Europa and Zeus. So if you're a Greek and you're conquering land in Asia, you're a metaphorical son of the bull and Europa, because you're a European now conquering land in Asia. So I think that if you give a vague prophecy that says the son of the bull was going to conquer a lot, something as bland as that, all sorts of Greek successors, Diadochoi from the first to the fifth or 10th generation, can claim that description fits them and make whatever use of it they can for propaganda purposes. But then I'm thinking, where else does the Greek bowl, does the bowl appear? Where else can I think about it? And, you know, I'm sure it's on tons of coins as you've been talking, but I'm now trying to think about other stories, you know, like the bowl from the sea with Poseidon. That didn't help me on Crete. And these semi-monstrous bowls that I think Heracles fights, that didn't help me either. But I kind of think there's some city that's founded that has something to do with a bull crossing a stream. Does that sound familiar to anybody? And that's a significant thing? It's an important city so that if somebody comes from that city, they could be the fulfiller of the son of the bull. I can't figure out where this is from. So if anybody knows what this is, their recall is much better than mine, which is now atrophied by severe old age. So I throw that out, if that means anything, that there are these weird prophecies about when the bull does such and such. And I think there's some city that is founded because the founder is supposed to watch for a bull to, you know, cross a stream or something like this. It's the equivalent of Aeneas. When you see the sow with 30 piglets, that's where you should found your city. You know, it's a different one of these foundational myths. Sorry, I'm not able to connect it for you. But I do like the idea that I picked up from the guy who, Berkeley professor from 50 years, Fontenrose, who wrote about how the Delphic Oracle is usually fairly specific up until about 500 or later BC. And then they become more and more ambiguous in the way they're recorded to us, but that Fontenrose actually thinks they remain specific. We just get a weird subset of ambiguity. That may be a dead end, but I hope it can somehow not be a dead end to give you something good to look up.
Yeah, thank you. I will think about it. About this Lucas as a bull who stole Europe, Princess Europe, and crossed the sea. I think that it's well known that in later times, Seleucus was worshipped as Seleucus tells Seleucus Zeus Nicator in the list of the Seleucid royal guards, Seleucid kings from Seleucia in Pieria. We know that in his last campaign, Seleucus also crossed the strait Hellespont, but it was a bad idea for him because another oracle predicted that if he will return to Europe, he will die. So he, in one sense, he was a bull who crossed again the narrow strait of Hellespont.
The Bosporus, right?
But he died, and he was not a real Zeus who can cross the seas and straits freely, like a real god. Thank you.
I am still musing about the emphasis on on Zeus rather than Apollo. Since you suggested a date for the prophecy in the 260s, when the newer court ideology of Seleucus being the son of Apollo had already become the official version, the more official version, but of course the previous imagery shaped by Seleucus himself as being, well, the taurine or the Zeus-like was still prevalent, and it never got completely lost, as also on your second last slide, the last inscription from Seleucia in Pieria that you quote. So this second capital, or perhaps even first capital of the Seleucids in the Mediterranean, preserved a priesthood that included Seleucus Zeus Nicator, Kai Antiochus Apollon Soter. So it's a combination of these two traditions. But that is still something that makes me think and makes me wonder whether there might have even been an earlier Phaenis oracle on Zeus. For Seleucus himself, which cannot, of course, have been on the Galatians, because the Galatians came into play only when Seleucus was dead, and clearly this oracle that you have discussed here must relate to Antiochus the First. That's all very convincing, but I wonder what would have caused the very strong emphasis on Zeus, not mentioning Apollo in any way here, although it is related to the victory of Antiochus, Apollo Soter over the Galatians. And at a later stage, we see then that the Soter ideology was clearly related to this victory. So I wonder whether there might have been an earlier version, so that Phaenis was already accepted as the prophetess making an oracle on Seleucus, and that would have had the emphasis on the son of Zeus, and includes perhaps including the motif of the bull. I'm just wondering again. I'm juggling to try to find that out. It's not necessary, because the old motif may still be continued. And it does not at all contradict your argument, but I wonder whether we can explain the omission of Apollo a little bit better for your assumed year of around the 260s, and that would have continued also in the 250s and later on, because then it became canonical even more so.
Yeah, thank you. Great idea. I will think about it.
And Stephen, you have something.
Yeah, thank you. I really enjoyed your paper, and I think what I'm going to say doesn't challenge what you said at all. It really picks up on something that Alti said, which is one of the things I find really interesting in the paper is the kind of ambiguity of these stories. That if Antiochus here is the son of the bull, that makes Seleucus the bull, but Seleucus isn't the bull. Seleucus is the bull wrestler in the other story in Appian, right? And those are different allusions and playing with different things. And for me, when I look at that story, I always think about wrestling the bull is like being, akin to Heracles. It's a claim to legitimacy within an Argead tradition in which Alexander's family had claimed descent from Heracles, right? But then this takes it in a very different tradition. And I think, this is something that you do. I think we sometimes want to tie all of these loose ends up, and we want to have these kind of neat little stories or neat little parables about how things work. And actually, sometimes we miss some of the complexity of it because so little of what was created survives, and we want it all to connect together. And I think one of the things your paper showed me was that there is scope for this kind of ambiguity. There's scope for Apollo and Zeus to still be influential. There's kind of, these stories don't become canonical overnight, they take time and that kind of thing. And that was one of the things I really took from the paper, was the ambiguity of some of that early Seleucid discourse, which is tapping into all of these different traditions and then coming down to us through very different lenses sometimes, I think. So yeah, that was something I took from the paper that I found really, really interesting. So thank you.
Yes, thank you. I totally agree. This is very interesting ambiguity of two images, and Taurus and Zeus and Apollo and of course Seleucus and Antiochus. Very interesting case, this prophecy. It was a real pleasure for me to work on this topic, and thank you for your ideas on this.
Well, the good thing is that we are recording so that we can also go back to these ideas very easily. And Actually, I'd like to now connect some thoughts from Stephen and from Marijn. So yeah, they are very, so the texts that we have, they have gone through very obscure paths, whether the text as such or whether individual motifs then in these texts. And let us not forget that the starting point of your argument, Kathy, that was to contradict Pausanias, who was convinced that this Phaenis oracle was geared towards Attalos the first, and then he tries to support it with something he has heard about a tradition that names Attalos as the horned one. That is something perhaps we should think about a little bit more. For us, when we see all the overwhelming evidence for Seleucus being the horned one, the one related to the bull, for us looking or knowing that Antiochus is one of the first and then the most prominent Galatian defeaters, whether or not his victory was more real or more diplomatic or more imagined is a completely different matter. But still, Pausanias, who also had very far-ranging ranging knowledge, chose to support the tradition that this is on Attalos. And I think we should, I think he had a tradition that related him to Attalos. And since we know that he, or that there is, Polybius, for example, as an important source, was very fond of Attalos, and praised him in his obituary and made the Galatian victory the core element of his kingship. And then we further know that, as you mentioned, that Attalos too had the Soter title claimed due to his victory over the Galatians, paralleling or even rivaling Antiochus I, who was known as the Soter, and by that time probably the Soter title was related to the Galatians, even though we know from inscriptions that it's earlier, that it predates the arrival of the Galatians and was probably initially related to the liberation of Asia Minor from Lysimachos on the one hand, and on the other hand, of the growing importance of the Apolline imagery. So what I think, or what I'm trying to get at, is that probably Attalos, or the court of Attalos, was drawing on the Phaenis oracle on Antiochus Soter, and was then trying to slightly readapt it or reattribute it very explicitly. And the question is, can we find traces of this reattribution? And can we find not only traces within this Phaenis oracle, but also in the tradition of Attalos? So Attalos, said to be by Pausanias as the one who was the horned one or so. Is there any other tradition or in any visual representation of Attalos with horns? I think, Oleg, you want to join in, please.
Yes, this is a question that I would like to talk about. As for Attalos, I think that really the information of Pausanias, when he confused the events, when he confused the rulers, should be understood as a result of existence of Attalos' attempt to appropriate the prophecy that was given to Antiochus, really. This attempt could be quite understandable in the context of, at first, royal aspirations of Attalos, at second, his Galatian victories, and the third but not least, from my point of view, this is the reason why he could be called Taurokeros. He's supposed partly Seleucid origin.
Yes, I want to
because,
say.
Because we know that his mother was Antiochus, the daughter of Archias, of course. And unfortunately, Alex McAuley is absent here, but he could tell us very interesting things about the origin of Achaid dynasty. But if we suppose that there was a real connection between the branch of Archias and the royal house of Seleucus, it could be a reason for Attalus at first to proclaim himself as a king. It was very serious background from my point of view, because his family was not so famous. Was let's remember that Strabo says that and other sources tell us about the low origin of the Attalids. And at second, it could be a content pretext to use this very unusual epithet Astaurocheros, the connection with Seleucid royal house, and it could be for him as ground to appropriate the oracle firstly given to Antiochus. And as for Phaenis, from my point of view, we could tell about the conventional Phaenis that prophecies, whether real or not, but connected with the Galatian prophecies, first of all, as the Simmers example shows. Because that prophecy that was given to Nicomedes I is very detailed, very it shows that it also was very well informed was informed very well on the course of events in Bithynia, in Thracia, in Byzantium, connected with the Galatian invasions, and maybe that it was confusion of various traditions anyway it was connected with the Galatian prophecies first of all. Thank you.
Yes, and I want to add about the connection between Attalid and the Seleucid dynasties. I very liked the hypothesis of Alex McAuley about the connection between Attalus and Seleucus through the supposed daughter of Seleucus, who may be a wife of Attalus the Elder. It could explain why the male names in the dynasty of Archias in his family are like archaic, and the girls in his family bear Seleucid names, Laodike, Antiochus, and Antiochus in that case was maybe named after Antiochus the satyr. I wrote a small article about Archias. It was my favorite feature in the early Hellenistic period, the Archias and his family. So if this is true, can explain us why Attalus connected or even connected himself with Seleucus the bull, but not in the line with Antiochus the first, because we know that Pergamon and the Seleucus were enemies most part of the history. So he thus he to counterpart between the Seleucid version of these events and replaced Antioch was the first by himself, maybe not Attalus himself, but maybe the kings after him, or even in later tradition, as I told.
Thank you. That, to me, that all makes sense. And I also look forward to reading your Achaios paper, which I have not yet seen, but I am preparing a little study also on the family of Achaios with some variation to Alex McAuley's reconstruction. But in essence, the arguments that you've put forward on the female names only showing up, I fully agree that this is the result of no male ancestor coming from the direct Seleucid stem, but only Antioch, starting with Antiochus, a female line comes in, and that then leads to the popularity of the name of the Seleucid women also amongst the in that family. I think when we put the pieces together now, would it be a plausible next step to think that Phaenis did not write about Antiochus? Rather, there was an oracle on Antiochus as the son, but Phaenis is perhaps more related to the Attalid court, because the other oracles, they seem to be related to Mysia or the region of Ilion and the Hellespontic region with that geographic focus. I wonder whether the prophetess, whether real or a pseudo prophetess or a pseudo identity, then took over the Seleucid prophecy and then republished it, adjusted it, and so that Phaenis may be more closely related to the Attalids, and the reference to her birth date would not at all conflict with it. So a birth date late in the 280s would fully be compatible with that assumption. Of course, it's nothing firm yet, but I think the pieces are converging in that direction. Ekaterina, you want to say something, but and then Giovanna?
Yes, about your thoughts. It's another question here, I guess, but how we can explain another oracle attributed to Phaenis that was given to Nicomedes first. If she lived in later times in the lifetime of Attalus, it's different in generations. I think it's a problem here.
Okay.
What do you think about it?
Yeah, we'll have to see, put all the pieces together, and I do not have them present because I know you are, your family is the collected expertise on Phaenis. Giovanna.
Yeah, just following up on the question of the relationship between Phaenis, this figure, and possibly the court of Pergamon. Actually, when I was studying this prophecy, I was playing with the idea that there was a cultural policy of the Attalids in Epirus. Now, I mean, your paper has given me a lot of food for thought, and I will have to rethink everything in a good way. So the idea is that I will take part of my chapter. So there is a storyline in Pausanias 1:11-2 of the hero Pergamos, who is an Epirote hero, who lived Epirus, reached Asia, joined Grinus, the grandson of Telephus, which is linked to the genealogy of Pergamon. Together with together with Grinus, they engaged in a war against Euthrania in Mysia, And Pergamus, the hero, killed this king, killed the king of Mysia and took his ring. He eventually changed the name of its capital into Pergamon. So it seems there is in Pausanias at least. So Pausanias seems to be very Attalid oriented. And there seems to be this idea of a genealogical link between Pergamus and Epirus. So I wonder whether that can fit into maybe the prominence of this prophetess of Dodona in Epirus within a sort of Attalid retelling of the oracle. I mean, I know it's a lot of very different ideas here, but I wonder whether that maybe can fit what Altai was saying.
Yes, thank you. I will take it into consideration. Maybe it will explain this link between Pergamon and Epirus, but I think it late feature of the literature of Pausanias himself, I think, it's not connected maybe with the Attalids, because Telephos, the future of Telephos is very complicated, because it reminds me, of course, the Hittite connections with Telepinus and, of course, Anatolian background of the history of Pergamon. But this example from Pausanias, from the same author, it's very important, and I consider it. I'll think about it. Thank you.
So we are reaching the end of our session, and I think we should give Ekaterina a break here, not though without thanking her so much for this excellent presentation and for the lively, collegial, productive discussion that it has started. And I hope that this discussion will be ongoing. So hopefully many emails will be exchanged, and we'll see how the idea develops further. And we, of course, then also look forward to its publication, hopefully in the near future. So thank you very much again, Ekaterina. And
thank
also
you very much for you all.
Also, thank you very much, Marijn, for assisting us and stimulating so much thought, thanks to your thoughtful comments. I am now, saying goodbye, though again, not without announcing our next event, which will be somewhat different. It will not be a lecture in the traditional sense, but on June 21, we would like to reconvene for a book launch, the first volume in the new series, Seleucid Perspectives, which is on Seleucid ideology, creation, reception, and response. And we are still working creatively and do not yet know how this event will unfold, but we will hope, we hope we'll have many guests, many active participants to celebrate the publication. Well, we hope that it will be published by the time of the volume, which is still with the press, but will hopefully be released very soon. So thank you to all of you again, also to all of you who participated in our discussion, and I wish you a marvelous spring. Farewell.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.